devices and antennas. We are now at the ESAT-5. I am Engineer Randy Aliado from MORF Cebu. Okay, these are our subtopics ngayong araw. We have waveguides. We'll be discussing waveguide accessories as well. Then we will be talking about the waveguide derived components, antennas, then resonant antennas, and antenna arrays. Okay, let's define first what is waveguide. Ano ba yung waveguide? So basically, it's the guide for your electromagnetic waves. So ganun lang ka simple, no? So masasabi natin na pag transmission lines, ito ay nagkikere ng signals from transmitter to the receiver. But the difference nito sa waveguide is yung transmission lines intended to be used at the lower spectrum, while the waveguides are basically used doon sa microwave na, no? So alam kasi natin na yung ating mga signals will only be radiated in a transmission line because nga transmission lines are low pass filters. So ibig sabihin yung mga high frequency signals will just be radiated such as the microwave. So para meron din tayong guided transmission medium for the microwave, so we will be having our waveguides discussion ngayon, no? Okay, so waveguide basically is the guide for your wave. So it's a hollow metal conducting pipe designed to carry unconstrained. So dapat hindi makawala yung electromagnetic wave mo, no? Such as microwave signals. No? So that is basically the definition of waveguides. Parang tubo lang, no? Parang tubo. And it comes with different shapes. We have rectangular waveguides, we have circular, and we have also elliptical waveguides. And all of these are made of conductors, no? Made of conductors such as copper, aluminum, or brass. So yun yung mga metals na ginagamit natin to manufacture or create these waveguides. Now, isa sa pinaka-popular na waveguide sa ngayon, no, is yung elliptical sa cellular technology, no? Because meron siyang degree of bending, hindi kagaya ng mga rectangular at saka circular. Yung ating elliptical guides, pwedeng mabend ng konti, no? So hindi siya ganoon ka stiff kumbaga. So this inside of the waveguide also are sometimes coated with silver para mas liliit pa yung resistance niya and makip yung losses into minimum value lang. So that would be dito sa mga waveguides na to. Now para mas maintindihan natin lalo yung waveguides, let's talk about how these signals will be put into the waveguide. Or di kaya paano natin tanggalin or extract yung signal sa waveguide. There are actually three, no, methods para ma-inject or ma-extract yung signal sa loob ng waveguide. We have the probe, we have the loop, and also we have the hole or aperture. No? So we will talk about this parang antenna na maliliit, no? The probes and the loops. Now the probe is a 1/4 wavelength vertical antenna placed at 1/4 wavelength din from the closed part of the waveguide. So isipin lang natin na yung loop is para sa electric field, para hindi natin makalimutan kung saan siya ilalagay. So electric field is synonymous din yan sa voltage. So if meron tayong transmission line, balik tayo sa transmission line na concept. So kung meron tayong transmission line and that is terminated as short, we know that the impedance at the short is minimum. And using Ohm's law, so my voltage there is minimum and my current there is maximum. So I cannot put a probe at the shorted side of your waveguide because nga yung voltage doon minimum. So we need to make sure na kung saan natin ilagay yung probe na yan is nagkakaroon siya ng electric field or voltage na maximum. And we know that in every quarter wavelength from determination, there exists an impedance inversion. So ibig sabihin dito, meron ka ng maximum impedance using Ohm's law. Ganun pa rin, the voltage will now increase and the current will now decrease. So ibig sabihin, at 1/4 wavelength from the shorted part ng ating transmission line, meron na tayong maximum dito na bultahe. So doon na natin pwedeng ilagay yung probe. So kaya nga, yung probe must be placed dito, 1/4 wavelength from the closed part ng ating waveguide because dito sa part na to, malakas yung bultahe, tapos mahina yung kuryente, parang ano, no? So malakas yung electric field, mahina yung magnetic field. So this sets up the electric field. So parang yung concept dito is dahil sa electric yung parang pinapapasok natin because of that lambda over 4. So once ma-set up na yung electric field, bubuo din yung kanyang magnetic field para magkaroon ng electromagnetic field inside the waveguide. So the other one naman is the loop. So the loop naman is magnetic. So yun yung isipin natin. Pag probe electric, pag loop, that would be magnetic or H. So that is synonymous also to current. So because in our discussion here kanina, at the short, you have already maximum current. So in your waveguide, you need to put your loop at the closed part na talaga. No? So place at the closed part of the waveguide, because at this end part of your waveguide, you have maximum na kuryente, kumbaga, and minimum na boltahe. So maximum magnetic field, minimum electric field. So what really is nangyayari dito sa loop na to is siya yung magbi-build up ng magnetic lines of force na forming into loop, di ba? Naalala natin sa electronics na yung mga magnetic lines of force is kaiba doon sa ating electric lines of force, because electric lines of force will only be radiated but will never create any loop, no? Whereas the magnetic lines will always form into loops. So kaya nga yun yung ating loop. It will set up parang magnetic muna, then sasabay na doon yung kanyang electric field. So if you can inject your signals using a probe and a loop, then obviously you can also extract it using the loop and the probe. Yung hole naman, madidiscuss natin yan mamaya sa directional coupler. So if I have two waveguides na nakakopol ng ganito, pwede akong maglagay ng butas dito, aperture, so that a signal from here will enter to the other signal, so to the other waveguide. So that could also be used in order to either inject or maybe extract signal from the waveguide. So we could also use that. No? Okay, so now let's move on to the cutoff frequency. So ibig sabihin, yung waveguide natin meron siyang cutoff frequency. So it means na filter din pala yung ating waveguide. Kasi pag circuit ka, tapos meron kang cutoff frequency, filter ka. Eh meron tayong cutoff frequency dito, so filter din pala yung waveguide. But ano kayang uring filter yung waveguide? Because we know that transmission lines are low-pass filters. No? So alamin natin. So the cutoff frequency of a waveguide is the lowest frequency that is used to mark the propagation of a signal in a waveguide. So lilinawin natin that this cutoff frequency is never equal to your operating frequency. No? So hindi ibig sabihin ng cutoff frequency, yun yung ginagamit mong frequency sa loob ng waveguide or frequency ng signal mo. So a cutoff frequency is a limiting frequency. Kumbaga it's a specification, no? Na gagamitin mo para malaman mo na simula doon pataas, yun na yung frequency that could propagate inside the waveguide. So based ating formula dito, galing lang talaga yan sa cutoff sa lambda na formula, no? So lambda is equal to C over F. So ibig sabihin, balik na rin ko, F is equal to C over lambda. So if this is cutoff, then this could also be cutoff. So the cutoff frequency is equal to C over the cutoff wavelength, where C is the speed of light. Now the cutoff wavelength is actually equal to 2A over M. So the A actually is the longer dimension of your waveguide. So if this is your waveguide, itong mahaba na to, ito yung A dimension, and itong mas maikli na to, ito yung B dimension. So that would be the A. Itong M naman is bilangin lang natin kung ilang half wavelengths yung nag-exist sa A dimension. So for example, guguhit ako dito ng isang kalahating wavelength, ayan, ng electric field halimbawa, then I could say that my M there is equal to 1. So assuming lang that ito yung ating mode ng propagation sa waveguide na meron tayong M equal to 1, then we could simply substitute this M with equal to 1. So when M is equal to 1, then my lambda cutoff will be equal to 2A na lang. So my cutoff frequency now will be equal to, if this would be equal to 2A, then my cutoff frequency now will be equal to C over 2A, such as this. So this formula is actually applicable lang doon sa mga waveguide modes na yung inyong A dimension is meron lang 1/2 wavelength. So kung meron siyang isang kalahating wavelength, then you can apply this formula. But this is not applicable sa lahat. No? So mamaya-maya, i-discuss din natin yan. So based dito, meron tayong statement, no? That at F or frequency of operation that is less than or equal to the cutoff, waveguides will not transmit energy. So ibig sabihin, hindi pala makakapag-transmit ng energy yung ating waveguide if yung frequency mo is mas mababa pa or equal lang sa cutoff. But if your frequency is now greater than the cutoff frequency, the waveguide will now propagate the energy. So dun pa lang, alam na natin na lower than the cutoff or equal to the cutoff, the waveguide will not propagate your energy. But higher than the cutoff, the waveguide will propagate the energy, telling us that these particular waveguides are basically mga high-pass filters. So high-pass filters. So ayun, meron na tayong separation. No? Transmission lines are low-pass filters, whereas waveguides are high-pass filters. Okay, so now let's move on to the dominant mode. Now, from the word dominant, it means ito yung pinaka-best mode ng operation natin, ng ating waveguides. So, dominant mode is actually a single mode of propagation lang. No? Single mode propagation means you only have one path for the signal to travel down the waveguide. So, and this could be achieved by using the lowest cutoff frequency lang. So, ibig sabihin, bawat waveguide, meron palang maraming cutoff frequency depende sa mode mo. No? But if you will use the lowest cutoff, then that tells you na yung mode na ginagamit mo is the single mode. So, the difference between the single mode and multi-mode is shown here. Pag sinasabi mo single mode, there is only one path for your signal to travel down the waveguide. And pag sinabi mo multi-mode, marami ng mode, marami ng paths. No? So, always remember that if this is the waveguide top view, we can never propagate the wave inside the waveguide in a straight path. Doing that will short the electric field components of your waveguide and of your electromagnetic energy. That in return will actually make it na hindi mag-propagate. So, in short, for our electromagnetic energy to propagate inside the waveguide, we need to make sure that it will reflect from wall to wall inside your waveguide. So, it can never travel straight. No? It should reflect from wall to wall inside your guide. So, ito na yung kaibahan. No? Single mode, isang daan lang, isang path lang na dinadaanan ng ating signal. Pag multi-mode, marami na silang path. No? So, this single mode is better than the multi-mode because this multi-mode may lead to the arrival of your signals with different times, creating a stretching of your pulse. No? So, pag meron kang pulse dito na sabay sana silang umalis, pero pagdating dito sa dulo, nauna na yung isa, tapos nahuli na yung isa, like ito yung nauna. Tapos after a while, dumating yung isa. So, nakikita natin na yung pulse natin is parang humaba na, no? Na-distort yung pulse natin. Naghalo na sila, so that could lead to what we term as dispersion. So, kaya nga, it is always better to operate on the dominant mode because that would be having minimum dispersion. Now, for the dominant mode standards ng ating mga waveguides, the rectangular waveguides have a dominant mode of operation, TE10, whereas the circular waveguides naman has a TE11 na dominant mode. So, tingnan natin, no? Yung tinatawag na transverse electric and transverse magnetic na operation. So, let's begin with the transverse magnetic. Now, pag sinasabi mong transverse magnetic, ibig sabihin nun, perpendicular yung magnetic. So, transverse means perpendicular. Perpendicular yung magnetic saan, no? So, yun yung alamin natin. So, sabi dito, the magnetic field component is perpendicular to the direction of propagation or the waveguide length. So, ibig sabihin, the magnetic field exists across or perpendicular sa waveguide and it doesn't exist along the guide, no? So, if the magnetic field is existing across the waveguide, then because the electric field is also perpendicular with the magnetic field, then it would be the electric field na nag-exist along the waveguide. So, magnetic field will exist across and the electric field will exist along. So, para mas makita natin, it looks like this. So, if this is the length of the guide and this is the direction of travel, your signal needs to reflect back and forth like this. Diba? So, it should travel in these directions and resultantly, it would be moving towards the length of the guide. So, illustrating what will happen in a transverse magnetic mode, it would be like this. So, si magnetic field daw nag-exist across. So, this would be the magnetic field existing perpendicular dun sa length ng ating guide or direction of travel, and it would be the electric field na mag-exist on that direction of travel or along that direction of travel. So, ibig sabihin, si across is si magnetic field, tapos si along is si electric field. So, that would be the relationship natin. So, ngayon, para mas maintindihan natin how it looks like inside the waveguide, alam natin na yung mga electric field components are basically mga lines yan na hindi naglo-loop. Whereas the magnetic lines are mga lines na naglo-loop. So because naka-vertical yung ating mga lines, so we'll draw vertical lines dito. No? So ito yung mga magnetic lines of course natin. But because they need to create a loop or they need to always loop, so we need just to make a loop here. So ito na yung mga magnetic lines of force natin na nag-create ng loop. Ayan. So because nakaganyan yung ating mga mga magnetic lines, so they exist across. So yun na yung ibig sabihin niya, no? They exist, nakatayo sila. They are existing across the waveguide natin, or haba ng ating waveguide o direction ng propagation. Whereas the electric lines of force naman is nakapunta doon, no? So ito dapat yung direction ng mga electric lines of force. So we could actually draw it as ito yung magnetic natin. We could draw it na nandito sila sa gilid, papunta doon na direction, no? So that would be the electric lines of force natin. Ayan. So see, they are moving along the length of the guide, whereas these particular magnetic lines are existing across the guide. So that would be the transverse magnetic. So in short, pwede rin natin sabihin na sa transverse magnetic mode, walang mga electric lines that exist across because they exist along. Pwede rin natin sabihin na walang mga magnetic lines that exist along because they exist across. So that would be transverse magnetic. So for the transverse electric, baliktarin lang natin yun. Oh. So si transverse electric means perpendicular yung electric field doon sa direction ng propagation, or di kaya doon sa ating haba ng waveguide. So it means na the electric field now will exist across, whereas the magnetic field will exist along. So illustrating it inside your waveguide, it means na si electric field nag-i-exist across. So pag across, it's perpendicular. So ibig sabihin, ito na yung ating electric field because nga ito yung direction ng travel, direction ng ating waveguide. So ibig sabihin, yun na yung ating electric field, para perpendicular siya doon. So si magnetic field daw nag-i-exist parallel. So along means parallel. So if yun yung direction ng travel, then ito yun din yung direction ni magnetic field. So kasalungat doon sa kanina, no? So kanina nakatayo yung magnetic, nakahiga yung electric. Ngayon naman, because it's transverse electric na, nakatayo na yung mga electric, nakahiga na yung magnetic. So para makita natin yan dito, pwede nating sabihin na nakahiga na ngayon yung mga magnetic. So we will draw lines na parallel sa direction ng travel, o parallel doon sa ating length ng waveguide. Tapos guhit lang tayo ng loop para maging magnetic siya. So always remember na pag loop, magnetic talaga yan. Pag straight lines lang, that would be the electric lines. So yun na yung forma ng ating mga magnetic lines of force. Tapos yung ating electric is nakatayo. So ibig sabihin, sila yung mga nakatayo dito across the length of the guide. So yun na yung ating transverse electric na mode. And obviously, yung kanina sinabi doon na the dominant mode for rectangular waveguides is TEMN0. Ano yun yung pag-uusapan natin ngayon? No? The TEMN format ng ating modes of operation. Now, sabi ko kanina, yung M is a number of half wavelengths in the A dimension, whereas the N is the number of half wavelengths in the B dimension. So it should be like this, no? So malinaw yan, no? Yung M natin, number of half wavelengths na nakikita sa A dimension, whereas yung N is number of half wavelengths pa rin na nakikita sa B dimension. So alalahanin lang natin na yung ating formula talaga ng cutoff frequency is C over lambda cutoff. And if naalala nyo, lambda cutoff is equal to 2A over M. So yun talaga yung formula natin, di ba, kanina. So gagamitin natin yan ngayon para mas ma-appreciate natin yung mga iba't ibang klase ng modes. Now let's begin with the TE10 mode. So the TE10, ibig sabihin ng TE is naka-exist yung ating mga electric fields across. Ibig sabihin ng 1 is meron tayong isang 1 half wavelength sa A dimension. So guhit tayo ng isang lambda over 2 sa A dimension, and this would be across the waveguide. So this would be the electric lines of force. So ito yung ginaguhit natin, the electric lines of force existing across the length of the waveguide with 1 half wavelength sa haba ng A dimension, in which in our example is 150 millimeters as provided. So let's try to find out kung ano kaya yung cutoff frequency ng waveguide nito na operating at TE10. So applying our equations, lambda cutoff is equal to 2A over M. The A is provided, which is 150 millimeters. The M is makikita natin sa ating mode, which is 1. So we can cancel this and make it into 1. That leaves us with a 2A na lang na cutoff wavelength. So if my cutoff wavelength is 2A, following this equation here, C over 2A, C over cutoff wavelength, and my cutoff wavelength is 2A, so I could now create this equation here, which is equal to 3 times 10 to the 8 meter per second divided by 2 times 150 millimeters. So now you may get your calculator and calculate here, 3 times 10 to the 8 meters per second i-divide natin yan sa 2 times 150 millimeters. Ah, so that should give us a value na 1 gigahertz. So yun na yung cutoff frequency natin at this dimension na A, 150 millimeters with an operating mode na TE10. So let's try and find out kung ano yung mangyayari, ano yung kaibahan ng TE10 sa TE20 provided na hindi nagbago yung waveguide natin. Our waveguide here still has an A dimension of 150 millimeters. But this time around, it now has two 1/2 wavelengths na makikita sa A dimension. So to illustrate that, guguhit lang tayo ng dalawang 1/2 wavelength sa A dimension. So I have now one 1/2 wavelength and another one 1/2 wavelength in the A dimension, making two 1/2 wavelengths in the A dimension. Now, using the same format of the formula, 2A over M, in which yung M ko is already 2. So makakancel yan, leaving me a cutoff wavelength equal to A, so 150 millimeters. My formula now will become cutoff frequency is equal to C, which is 3 times 10 to the 8 meters per second, ayan, divided by the A, which is 150 millimeters. So getting your calculator and calculate this 3 exponent 8 meter per second divided by 150 exponent negative 3, that should give you a value of 2 gigahertz. So see, nagbago na ngayon yung ating cutoff from 1 gigahertz naging 2 gigahertz na siya, and that is from TE10 to TE20. So let's have another example, no? Para mas sulit natin to. Let's have another mode of operation, TE30. So TE30, it means na hindi pa rin nagbago, no? 150 pa rin na millimeters yung A dimension natin, but now this is operating at TE30. So at TE30, I will now draw tatlong half wavelengths dito. So I have now 1, 2, and 3 half wavelengths. And these are still electric field components because nga transverse electric yung ating waveguide. So yun na yung ating TE30. So following the same equation, my M now is tatlo na. No? So my M is 3. So I could represent this M with 3. That gives me with cutoff frequency is equal to C over cutoff wavelength, where my cutoff wavelength is now 2A over 3. So 2A over 3. So solving this, 3 exponent 8 meters per second divided by 2 times 150 millimeters over 3, that should give me a value of 3 gigahertz. So nagbabago-bago yung ating cutoff frequency depende sa mode, even if pareho lang yung dimension ng ating A side ng waveguide. So this concludes something. Pinakauna is that yung formula pala na FCO is equal to C over 2A is only applicable sa tinatawag natin na TE10. When it comes to TE20, iba na yung formula ng cutoff frequency mo. When it becomes TE30, iba na rin yung formula ng cutoff frequency mo. So it will now follow this format para sigurado ka na kahit ano man yung mode, alam mo yung cutoff frequency. Now, among this TE10, TE20, and TE30, which is the dominant mode among these three? Now, sinabi kanina sa definition ng dominant mode na it is a single mode of propagation ng waveguide mo that will or that can be achieved by using only the mode with the lowest cutoff frequency. So we have three modes now in the same waveguide na may A dimension of 150 millimeters in this example. Alin ba dito sa TE10, TE20, TE30 yung gumagamit ng pinakamababang frequency? And the answer there is 1 GHz. Therefore, among these three, the dominant mode uses the lowest cutoff, which is this 1 GHz, kasi 2 GHz, 3 GHz, pinakamababa yung 1 GHz. And sino yan? The TE10. So that explains na kanina sinabi na the dominant mode for rectangular waveguide is the TE10. So hopefully hindi mo makakalimutan why is the TE10 the dominant mode, no? Because kitang-kita natin sa ating explanation dito na it really is the mode that uses the lowest cutoff frequency. Okay, so now let's move on to the group and phase velocity sa loob ng waveguide. Now, there are two velocities sa loob ng waveguide, no? Si group at saka si phase. Now, the wave reflected from the conducting wall has two velocities in direction parallel to the wall, no? Alongside with the direction of propagation, no? Namely the group velocity and the phase velocity. Now, sabi dito that in free space daw, si group velocity is equal lang kay phase velocity. And actually, sa free space, the group velocity is 3 exponent 8 meter per second and the phase velocity is 3 exponent 8 meter per second, leading us to say na in free space, this group velocity times the phase velocity really just will become the c squared. So this is satisfied, no? Because nga equal yung vg at saka yung vp sa free space. So they will equal to c squared. But always remember na pagdating sa loob ng waveguide, these two velocities will no longer equal. And we will prove it, okay? So let's begin with the group velocity. Now the group velocity inside the waveguide is the actual velocity na ginagamit ng energy sa pag-travel ng sa loob ng waveguide mo, no? So the actual speed, ito talaga yung tunay na speed, no? At which the signal travels down the waveguide. But the idea is, because nga yung ating signal is hindi makapag-travel straight sa loob ng waveguide, it should always be reflected from wall to wall sa ating waveguide, hindi talaga aabot yung ating VG to the value of C, no? It can never be equal to C. Sabi nga ni Einstein, no? No velocity of energy can be greater than C. So if the group velocity can never be equal to C, then it also means that it can never be exceeding C. So in short, it is always less than the value of C. So based on this formula, we can also satisfy that the VG is always less than the value of C. So subukan natin. Now we know that waveguides are high pass filters, di ba? So waveguides are high pass filters. So in order for this to operate normally, we need to satisfy a condition here na CF is greater than FCO. Kasi nga high pass filter ka. So kung high pass filter ka, dapat yung operating frequency mo, yung F na yan, operating frequency mo should be greater than your FCO, di ba? So that would be greater than FCO. So when your F is greater than the FCO, this value here will become less than 1. Diba? When the denominator is greater than the numerator, then this fraction here will become less than 1. Less than 1, you square it, it still is less than 1. When 1 is subtracted by less than 1, it still is less than 1. When 1, when less than 1 is extracted yung square root nun, square root of less than 1, still it is less than 1. When a less than 1 is multiplied to C, we know that VG is always less than C. So for the normal operation of your waveguide, the group velocity will obviously equal, not equal but lesser than 1. So not lesser than 1 but lesser than C. So the group velocity is always lesser than C for the normal operation natin. So C always less than the speed of light in free space. Now what will happen naman to the group velocity if F is equal to FCO? So if F is equal to FCO, no? So if F is equal to FCO, like you are operating at your cutoff, no? You have your cutoff frequency na 1 GHz and you also operate at 1 GHz, no? So ano ba yung kararat na nun, no? So let's simulate. If F is equal to FCO, then this value here will equal to 1. So this will equal to 1. 1 squared is still 1. 1 minus 1 is 1, is 0, no? Square root of 0 is 0. 0 times C, VG will now equal to 0. So what is the indication if your VG equals to 0? It means that it will not propagate. So na-prove na naman natin na if your F is just equal to your cutoff, if you operate at your cutoff, in short, there will never be propagation of your signal inside the waveguide. Hindi siya magpo-propagate. And that is proven also by this equation here. So what really will happen is that as you operate at F equal to your FC, no? So halimbawa, at F equal to your FC, you know that your VG is equal to 0. So at F equal to FC, VG equal to 0. What really happens inside the waveguide is that this signal will just reflect back and forth here very fast and it will never propagate. But as the frequency increases from F, no? As the frequency increases from F, pag lalaki na yung F mo sa FC or rather, no? As the frequency increases from FCO, bigla na lang itong dahan-dahan na lang itong magpropagate like this. So still has multiple reflections but it is already moving. So meron ng propagation na nangyayari if your F becomes greater than FCO. As you increase further this F from FCO, mas bibilis na yung takbo ng inyong electromagnetic energy. Pag lalakihan mo pa yan kumpara sa FCO, mas lalo pang bibilis yung velocity mo known as VG. So in short, when your F is equal to FCO, you started your VG at 0. So dito ka nagsisimula sa 0 meter per second. As your F increases from FCO, lalaki and lalaki yung inyong group velocity. So, but it could never be equal to C unless na nandun ka na sa free space. So, kung nandito ka lang sa loob ng waveguide, hindi ka talaga aabot sa value ng C. So, makikita natin yan dito, no? As F increases from the cutoff, the VG will increase also. So, that's the property known as group velocity. Okay, tingnan naman natin yung kaibahan niya sa phase velocity. So, sa phase velocity, hindi talaga ito yung actual na velocity na ginagamit ng energy mo to travel inside the guide. This is just pagbabago ng angle. Kumbaga, no? So, the rate at which the wave appears to move along the guide based on the way the phase angle varies, kung gano'n kabilis magbabago na yung angle mo. No? So, looking at this equation, it is now C over D, 1 minus FC over F squared. And we know that in a normal operation, this 1 minus FCO over F squared is less than 1. So for normal operation, we know that the VP is equal to C over less than 1. So this VP obviously is greater than C for normal operation. So greater than C naman si VP, no? Always greater than C or greater than speed of light in free space. But what do you think is the VP at F equal to cutoff? So at F equal to cutoff, if frequency here is equal to the cutoff frequency, then this value becomes 1. 1 squared is 1, 1 minus 1 is 0, square root of 0, 0, C over 0 approaches infinity. So this will approach infinity pala if you are operating at the cutoff. But the group velocity when you operate at the cutoff is 0. So parang extreme sila, no? VG at the F equal to FCO is 0, but VP at F equal to FCO is equal to infinity. So, ano ba yung mangyayari if F is equal or VP is equal to infinity, no? So VP is infinity at F equal to FCO. Ano yung ibig sabihin niyan? So what really is happening here is that when your F is equal to FCO, alam natin that this will only reflect back and forth, di ba? Hindi siya nagkakaroon ng displacement, no? Displacement over time has a velocity equal to zero. But this phase angle, dahil sa bilis ng pagbabago na yan, approaches infinity, no? Yung pagbabago ng phase. But yung actual na displacement is wala. So kaya nga infinite yung kanyang pagbabago ng angle, but yung kanyang pagbabago ng distance over time is wala. So kaya nga yung VG niya is equal to zero. But the moment you increase your F from FCO, this will begin to propagate, di ba? Kanina may propagation na siya na nangyayari. Somehow, parang nakikita natin dito na meron ng konting time before magbabago yung phase ng ating mga signal. So, meron ng konting time, di ba? So, in short, from infinite na napakabilis na pagbabago ng ating phase, ngayon meron ng delay na pagbabago. So, it will take this time before it changes the phase. Take this time before it changes the phase. So, that would be somehow bumabagal siya. And alam natin na if this will be greater than the FCO pa, lalong bibilis yung group velocity natin, di ba? Lalong bibilis yung group velocity, but lalong babagal before it will change its phase. Kumbaga, lalong magkakaroon ng mahabang time before another phase ng wave mo is magbabago. And also, if lalagyan mo pa yan, lalong bibilis yung group velocity mo, but it will take so much time na before this angle or phase changes inside your waveguide. So, yun yung nangyayari. So, in short, makikita natin dito na si group velocity is magsisimula always sa 0 at F equal to FCO. So this is your VG. That would start at 0. Pero si VP magsisimula sa infinity at F equal to 0. Or not F equal to 0, but F equal to FCO. Now, as the F increases, yung relationship nila is si VG as F increases from FCO. I mean, si VG dahan-dahang lalaki at saka si VP dahan-dahang babagal. Until they meet at this point where your VP will equal na to VG. This cannot happen inside your waveguide. This can only happen sa free space. So approaching dito, that would be VP almost your C or VG almost your C. Yun na yung almost na straight line yung travel ng signal mo sa loob ng waveguide. But as long as there are still reflections pa rin sa loob ng waveguide, then your VG will never equal to your VP pa rin. So, ayan, no? So, as F increases from FCO, VP decreases. But kanina, as F increases from FCO, VG increases naman. So hopefully hindi kayo nalilito between the phase velocity and the growth velocity. So now let's move on to the impedance naman ng waveguide. So dalawa yung tatandaan natin, transverse electric and transverse magnetic. Now in the board exam, kung halimbawa hindi specify kung anong mode talaga yan, no? TE or TM, we always assume it to be the dominant mode, TE10. Automatic yan, no? So kaya nga pag tinatanong ka ng cutoff frequency sa board exam tapos hindi sinabi kung anong mode yan, automatic yung cutoff frequency formula mo is equal to C over 2A. That is dominant mode, TE10. Unless stated na iba yung mode, TE20, TE30. So that is also the same sa lahat ng applications ng waveguide problems natin. Basta hindi sinabi, assume it to be transverse electric. So kaya nga kung hindi sinabi, always divide 377 by your 1 minus FC over FC or over F squared. Unless i-provide nila na, uy, transverse magnetic yung tanong. So yun yung time na i-multiply. So yun yung mnemonic dyan, no? Magnetic means multiply, no? Tapos yung electric, yun yung i-divide mo. So ibig sabihin, for normal operation ng ating waveguide, the characteristic impedance ng transverse electric is always greater than 377, and for the transverse magnetic, always less than 377. So sino ba yan si 377? So si 377 actually is the characteristic impedance of free space, which we will discuss next meeting natin in wave propagation. Oh, so yun na yun. Oh. 377 is the free space impedance in ohms. It's a standard value. Okay, now to discuss naman the difference between the wavelength sa loob ng waveguide and the wavelength of that frequency sa labas, like in sa free space, ito naman yung formula. No? So alam natin that this value for a normal operation is always lesser than 1, di ba? Basta yung normal operation lang, less than 1 talaga yung value na to. So doon pa lang alam na natin na pag may tanong sa board exam na sasabihin, ano yung mas mahaba? Waveguide sa wavelength sa loob ng waveguide or wavelength sa labas ng waveguide, like in a free space. Now we know na if this is less than 1, the wavelength in free space divided by the less than 1 will create a value greater than the wavelength in free space. Then that concludes now na the guide wavelength pala or wavelength sa loob ng waveguide is mas mahaba in terms sa wavelength sa labas ng waveguide. And it could also be proven by this. So assuming these are your wavefronts, and these are your waves, now makikita natin dito na if ito yung tinatawag natin na wavelength sa ng signal natin sa labas ng waveguide, like this is the wavelength mo, this is the wavelength, ayan, ito yung wavelength mo ng signal talaga, yan yung wavelength ng signal mo sa loob ng waveguide. When you look at this wavelength, it would not be this wavelength. Kumbaga, if kukuha tayo ng wavelength dito, hindi ito yung wavelength natin sa loob ng waveguide, but ito yung wavelength natin sa loob ng waveguide, which is actually mas mahaba yan kumpara dito, no? So that would be obviously very short kumpara dito sa dimension na to. So ito yung guide wavelength, ito yung free space wavelength. So that is kitang-kita natin na the guide wavelength or the wavelength inside the waveguide is much longer than the wavelength sa loob ng wave, sa labas ng waveguide, which is now the free space na wavelength. So it could still also be proven by this equation right here. Okay, so now let's move on to waveguide accessories.